Hi there, guys, and welcome to the Chronicles of Gamers. This is a podcast where we love to explain our love-hate relationship with video games. And I am, of course, your host with the most, Efocutioner A. How's everyone doing today? You're listening to me talk to you or chat with you, here with you. Unless you're watching me on YouTube. Hey! Nah, but anyways, welcome to episode 115. I'm glad you were here. Shout outs to you guys coming through, watching 115, not just with me, but with you as well. And your significant other, or your sister, or your brother, or whoever. Even if you are just watching it by yourself, I appreciate you. Thank you so, so much. Yes, so episode 115, right? I think it's going to be a very interesting episode. This is something I kind of want to talk about, something that's been going on. Oh, by the way, man, you know, the GameStop thing. Oh, I'm so close to talking about it. And I'm going to keep mentioning it because when it comes, it's going to be like, oh, and hopefully by the end of it, it makes you want to just begin, try, think about investing, because I think investing is it's a great way to, and I know I'm saying but I think investing is a great way to not only build you know your assets, but at the same time you'll be able to figure out what's really important and what's really worth having versus like, do I really want to buy this? You know what I'm saying? Because now I'm starting to look at it in a way of when I make purchases, when I buy things, I look at it as just like, am I really going to be playing this? Am I really going to be watching this? Like, I'm starting to go back on my diet because I kind of went off it because, like, I was working out and kind of injured my leg while I was running up and down the stairs. So I kind of let myself go. But, I mean, just recently now, because it's just like, oh, man, I'm really starting to get this income. And I'm just like, do I even really want to go out and buy, like, a sandwich or them chips or them cookies? So it's just like, it's like a weird way of, it's a weird way of making yourself have a diet because you're going to save income more. But I do want to talk about the GameStop thing. But besides that, I really want to talk about this. So,
breaking news.
Fucking Guilty Gear Strive. Yes, I'm bringing this back up. Yes, I know how much you guys actually liked the last episode, even though I did not go into full detail about it. But yes, we're going back to motherfucking Guilty Gear. Guilty Gear Strive. Now, of course, the beta is over. There are some influencers that are still able to play. I'm not an influencer. So, first and foremost, I am not getting any money. I'm not getting any attention whatsoever by mentioning this game. I believe the game is decent. I believe the characters are decent. I have not been able to try the beta because I unfortunately missed downloading the beta. But by gosh, have I been paying attention to not just like the influencer streamers, but like also small streamers. I'm there. I'm watching and I'm paying attention. And the one thing I really want to talk about this game is Rollback Netcode. Online play. Why the fuck has it taken so long for us to get decent online play? So it's not even just the fighting game aspect, but it's just the whole aspect in general. And I like to use Guilty Gear Strive because it's the game where Arc Systems has been notoriously, for those unfamiliar, they've been notoriously horrible at making amazing games shit online. Everyone keeps saying they make amazing games shit online. That's pretty much consensus. And if you really think about it, and it's not just Japanese games, there's also some American games that seem to have this problem. When you play online and certain people mess with their router, do things, it messes up the online connection. So the reason why I think this Guilty Gear Strive is an amazing thing that's happening is because more companies are now really doubling down on online play. It's a very simple concept, but it's a concept I really want to emphasize because it's a great concept. Now, unfortunately, Guilty Gear Strive has kind of ended. It's gone. For those unfamiliar with Rollback Netcode, I can actually break that down because I know there's some people that have been hearing about Rollback Netcode, not just in fighting games, but kind of in other games too. And I figured out the best explanation for Rollback Netcode. So, oh wait, hold on, wrong music. This one. So, Rollback Netcode, folks, is basically where you put in an input, and then if something goes right, the input will continue. If there's something going on with the data packets, then it'll actually go back to where both players are able to play at a particular skill set. You know, like whatever you guys did at that particular time before one person's, you know, data packet was received to the server and back. But I found an easier and a better explanation to explain this. So, have you guys ever gone to the ATM or just gone to your bank and you wanted to get money out of your machine, right? You're actually doing a communicate, like, you know, you and the machine are basically playing with each other. You're putting in inputs and the machine is going to give you something out, correct? So, damn, I should have made that a little bit longer. I'm usually done before this time. Anyways, though, so, like you're getting your cash out of the ATM, correct? The beautiful thing about rollback netcode versus delay-based netcode is, say you go to this machine, say you put your card in the machine, say you input your numbers, you do everything correct, you input your cash. Now, at the end of this thing where you're inputting your cash, because you guys are basically doing this interaction, you're doing one thing, the machine's receiving that information, the machine's sending that information out to make sure it gets whatever you want to get your money out of the machine, and then it spits the machine, you know, tells the machine to give you this amount of cash, and then the machine gives you that cash, and you take that cash and go. So with delay-based netcode, as it is, say you want to take out $100, and you're pretty much done. It says, like, do you want to take out $100? You say yes. Now, you're wondering, why are you're waiting like 5 or 10 seconds after that yes confirmation. Like, it's just frozen. Like, you press that yes, you're waiting for it. You're like, what's going on? Like, you know, you're kind of just like,
it's spooky.
That, you know, you input it to you wanted this cash, but the cash isn't coming out. And then out of nowhere, it double checks, or it, you know, as it freezes, it didn't ask again, are you sure you want this money? And you're just like, yeah, man, I want this money. So you press it again, and then you have to wait a few more seconds, and then poof, you get your cash. Right? Now, that's kind of how delay, well, I'm trying to think of it as this way. That's kind of a very small, simple, short aspect of delay-based netcode, of basically saying, so you and the machine are communicating, right? You're inputting something, and the machine's receiving that. That information is going to where that cash is, and it's getting your cash together, but there's a little bit of delay between the information of the machine sending that information to get in the cash, and then the cash coming back out. And because of that, the machine is just like, oh, you know what? I'm not 100% sure, so let me just double check and ask. Well, not really double check and ask again, but the machine kind of sends like another confirmation. You get what I'm saying? Like, it's still got the cash ready. It's still saying, yo, $100, let's go. It's coming. Like, it's coming. you get what I mean? And then you're like, yes. And then it's just like, okay, so now it's double checking. Then it gets cash and then you can go. With rollback, it's kind of like, say you input it like, yo, you want $100? You say yes. And then it goes out. And then it gets that information, comes back, sends you the cash. Now, say there's a little bit of delay with the machine. What happens is, instead of you waiting a few seconds for that confirmation, rollback will actually just make sure, because it's like, you know what? I'm not 100% sure if he really wants this cash, even though he did say he wanted the cash, but just because a little bit of the information got misdirected, it's going to quickly ask, are you sure? And then you'll be like, yes. And then you're going to quickly get your cash. So, like, rollback is just going back to double check. Delay base is kind of just like, it's taking a minute to process that shit, while rollback is just like, yo, you made this confirmation, but then something happened. I'm going to double check in anyways and ask that information. Now, delay base really doesn't ask anything. What it does is just, it kind of assumes. So I'm kind of being nice, but that's what that freeze is, because sometimes even with delay base, and there are some delay base that are kind of like rollback, it goes through the action, but then it's not 100% sure. And so what it will do is, after those few seconds and not being 100% sure, it'll quickly just go back. With rollback, it does that, and then if it quickly sees a problem, it stops wherever it's at and quickly goes back to that situation and then continues going forward. So that is my best explanation of rollback and delay-based netcode. Of course, you can also Google this shit, but I think I did a pretty good job because I'm really trying to simplify it to a way that I feel like anybody can understand, and it could be like a real-world situation. And, we all have been trying to get cash out of our ATMs. Like, that's something that anybody should be able to do in a real-world situation. So, the whole point of this rollback netcode is, because of the success of the beta of Guilty Gear Strive, it has sparked this revolution. And I'm playing the Sonic music. It has sparked a revolution, not just in the FGC, but in all online play. Granted, shooters really don't have that much of a problem with their online play because, goodness forbid, most people really want to make sure that their multiplayer aspect of the shooter is just incredible, which annoys me to high heaven that for some reason for fighting games, something that should have been a necessity is a luxury, and it should not have been a fucking luxury, should have been a necessity. If you want this cash, it's a necessity. So, because of this, it has sparked a really beautiful revolution in online play, and I want to showcase that because I think this is very important, and it also goes back to motherfuckers who tell you that, hey man, just because you're going to boycott a game, it don't matter because other motherfuckers are going to buy the game, so who cares, and blah, blah, blah. No, bitch, as long as one motherfucker says no, and you tell other people the reason of the no, then you can actually do something. So this is how serious it's gotten since the rollback netcode. Now, this is just Guilty Gear Strive. Now, granted, a lot of these Japanese developers, Capcom, SNK, Arc System, Bandai Namco, they kind of had like this little get-together where they discussed, pretty much their whole entire fighting game situation, like the fighting games they're making, what can they do better. Online play, of course, that was a big thing that got talked about. So during that time, a lot of the developers were kind of just like, rollback is... Of course, once again, you can always Google it because I'm not going to do the research on that one because that's not really goes into my discussion of what I'm talking about. But one thing that's been very shocking was that SNK, King of Fighters 15, it's about to come out, man. I'm just kind of like... Apparently, SNK, their people didn't really make the big hype, the big hoopla, the big explanation on rollback netcode. They were kind of silent about it. So a lot of the SNK players, myself included, kind of got worried. We were just like, this doesn't seem right. You kind of want to have your shit together.
What the hell?
It'd be nice if you could tell us we got rollback netcode in KOF 15 because, I kind of want to purchase the game. So... For my audio people, I'm going to bring up a tweet. So this is literally SNK released a new character for King of Fighters 15. I'm not really going to introduce the character because, once again, that's not the point of what I want to talk about. What I want to talk about is on this tweet, they're introducing the character and they're talking about the character design for the new character in King of Fighters 15. Well, not really new, but like new for people that don't know. And for some of us that do, you'll recognize her quickly if you're watching the video version. But literally right after this tweet, the SNK global tweet of introducing Chizuru Kagura, and I know I'm saying her name right, guess what the first tweet is? Wow, that's crazy. Will KOF 15 have rollback netcode? So the game will be playable online? Oh my gosh, yo. And then who's the next person underneath? Yo, I agree with you. KOF 15's graphics are not good and the online's not good. It means that it has not invested. But look, as you go through this tweet, everyone is asking SNK. Hey, SNK. Hey, SNK over here. You got that rollback netcode? Be nice if you don't have that delay-based netcode, because if you have that delay-based, then I'm going to delay myself purchasing the game. And I'm like, holy crap, this is incredible. You get what I'm saying? So it's just like, oh my gosh. Yo, look at this. But look at this. Look at all these tweets. Look at all these tweets. Basically saying the same thing. Oh, except for this one. This one's kind of just talking about the outfit. But literally right after that, Rollback Netcode is, well, at this point, well, this one person, what is it? English Dragon. At this point, the Rollback begging is bordering on spam. Keep seeing that same message copy and paste. I understand if they confirm no Rollback, but they haven't. And then, like, literally a person after that whose name is, like, Rollback 2021. And he replies, which is why we have to bring it up 24/7 so they can announce it or not. So if, you know, so that way if he wants to purchase or not. And that makes sense, though. But this Rollback Netcode thing has really gotten steam. It's beautiful. I just want to give a special shout out, not just to SNK, but to, like, to fighting game players. It's gotten real serious, man. Like, yo, let me go to this next week. Like, at this point, Samurai Showdown, which, you know, came out and is about to have a new character, and I believe it's going to have a Guilty Gear character. I'm not really too sure, but there has been less and less players playing this game, all because the online fucking sucks. You can't even run a tournament on this thing anymore. People are removing Samurai Showdown from tournament play because this online is complete booty butt cheeks. Like, it's fucking crazy. And it's not even just that. The next tweet I'm showing right here by Angel Pickles, it literally states, we shouldn't have to pay, well, not that one. I think I got that one. Well, here it is. This one's from V/Freezer. This is, pretty much doing an online tournament once again. And they put, like, they had to remove Samurai Showdown because the online was horrible. And it's already having a really bad time showing KOF 14 online. And they're really thinking about removing it. And then, you know, and it's so bad that people don't want to play KOF 14 because the online play is horrible. And at this point, KOF 13 can be played, but it can be played on Parsec. So think about that shit. So here I'm showing Angel Pickles. That's basically saying we shouldn't have to pay for cloud servers, aka Parsec, to host lobbies and run tournaments, especially for a $60 game plus $6 for every DLC character or $14 for season passes, aka KOF 14 and 13. The offline scene was already hurting before the pandemic because of the netcode and lobbies. And that is the problem. KOF has had a horrible job at maintaining new people to play the game. It's been incredible. KOF 13 was probably at its hypest of the hypest. Like, it was incredible. Like, yo, man, I was playing that thing. I was moving around in tournaments. I was swigging and swagging. I was going in-state, out-of-state. At one point, I was in talks of trying to go to fucking, like, Mexico just to go fucking play. It's crazy at this thing, man. But at the same time, it's just in a horrible state because of how bad the online is, that the game quickly faded away. Online play is important, and I am loving this. I got the next week. There is fucking memes for SNK Rollback. I'm literally showing it right now for my audio people. It's hilarious at this thing. Look at this guy. Notorious BBC. That is a horrible name. But anyways, though. Like, look at the memes for this shit, bro. It's serious. Look at this. There is no lag at SNK. For those that have seen Avatar: The Last Airbender Season 2, Jolie? Look, man, look. You'll see it if you watch the YouTube for my audio people. Oh, that's a nice topic. Either way, I just want to state, yo, you can make a fucking difference. You can. And it's gotten to the point where people are willing to not purchase not just SNK games, not just KOF 15, but they're willing to not purchase any fucking fighting game. Any fucking fighting game. And I love that aspect. Thank you so much. It shows that gamers can unify and agree to something. It shows that we are not obligated to buy a fucking product. No one is you're not obligated for that. You don't need to attach yourself to a product so much that you blindly follow it. Because even the people who really love KOF are saying, fuck KOF. And if they can say it, anyone can fucking say it. And that's the bottom line. And I'm done with this discussion because I've talked quite a bit about it, but I'm just really passionate about it. Oh my gosh. And then this also goes into my last topic, so.
Breaking news!
And this one is gonna, this one's like kind of the same. So Paris, aka at Vicious 696. So of course we all found out the Horizon Zero Dawn is going to be on PC. And I know a lot of gamers that were really upset by this thing because they're like, well, that's bullshit. Why the hell did I even purchase a PlayStation 4 if Horizon Zero Dawn's going to be on PC? But this man pretty much sums it up in the most simplest of sentence. And here's what he says. We shouldn't be upset with more games coming to more platforms. Yes, exclusives are a part of the business and will continue to happen. But when there are exceptions to the rule, we should celebrate and support it. As gamers, we are the winners by having more options to where to play. PC is nice because you're able to mod and do whatever the fuck you want with that code. Now, if Horizon Zero Dawn comes out and it's complete booty butt cheeks, but you really like the first one, then you can mod the fuck out of it and make whatever the fuck you want, because that's the whole point of the PC space. Let motherfuckers have the games on different platforms. It's incredible that people are now playing Kingdom Hearts on fucking Xbox because they never bought a PlayStation. But the most important thing to remember is there's no reason to fucking be loyal to a damn company. I follow the games. Follow the games. PlayStation barely has games. Microsoft barely has games. PC's looking good. Am I a PC Master Race person? Absolutely fucking not. Hell to the no. But I know one thing for sure. On the PC, you could take a game like Left 4 Dead 2 and create multiple hours of fun because of mods and other people making better mods. And that's the beauty of it. PC just does a great job at that. But at the same time, there's no reason to be loyal to a fucking console. It's the stupidest reason ever. It's dumb. Yes, I understand that the main reason that you bought the PlayStation 4 is because you're like, oh shit, well look at the games. Well, guess what? You had X amount of years to enjoy Horizon Zero Dawn. Now let other people play. You pretty much have just showcased that PlayStation is the best place to go for games because they have games. And then years later, Xbox and PC has it later. So that's the whole point of buying the console. But at this point, even I get it. I understand console loyalty. I used to be that blind and that dumb. Like, oh man, I'm having a fun time playing Sega. Oh yeah, I love Sonic. And then, you know, after a while, like companies actually, you know, the console war didn't start with us. It started with companies. You know what I mean? And then we just kind of like really blew that shit up. Now everyone's looking like, bro, why am I only putting this thing on one console when I can make cha-ching over here, make that money over here? You know, but I get it. I get it. But for those that are upset at the fact that PlayStation put Horizon Zero Dawn, and I'm pretty sure they're going to put God of War. I'm pretty sure they're going to put Ratchet and Clank. I'm pretty sure they're going to put a lot more of their PlayStation exclusive games to Xbox and fucking PC. And I'm pretty sure Xbox is going to do the same fucking thing. I'm telling you, if they make a really good Halo game, don't be surprised if that motherfucker ends up on PlayStation. I'm telling you, that day is coming. If Ryu can be in Fortnite, Master Chief can be on PlayStation. Don't forget that shit. It's the money and the demand, and it can happen because a lot of people didn't even think that, what is it, Halo was going to be on PC. And I thought that was the craziest thing ever because I'm like, that would be the smartest thing ever because we'd be able to mod and do whatever we want. Fortunately, it's 343 version, so I'm like, but either way, we got it, you know? So I just want to say, for those that are upset by this thing, I want you to sit down and ask yourself, why? Why did you choose that console? Because I know why. I bought my PlayStation for, I know why I bought my PS4. I bought my PS4 for one motherfucking reason. More games versus Xbox. And I couldn't afford a PC. Two reasons, actually. I couldn't afford a PC at the time. And PlayStation had more games. And then, of course, at that time, the Xbox was kind of doing the online 24/7 thing. So that was like a really huge fucking X, you know. I was like, get the fuck out of here. But, you know, I technically left off listed three reasons. But, I mean, that was like some reasons on why I bought the PlayStation. Why did I buy the Xbox versus – why did I buy the Xbox 360 over the PS3? Because Xbox had more games. And Xbox had a better online, and Xbox had more games, and Xbox had more games, and Xbox had more motherfucking games. I'm following the games, people. You should be too. Why the fuck do you buy a console? These are questions you should ask yourself. Because if you're going to get upset and be like, you know, Origin no can't be there. If you're going to get upset over some stupid ass shit of a game being on another platform, why the fuck did you buy that platform? Yo, I'm waiting for the day Nintendo is just like, you know what? Let's release Mario on PlayStation. I'm waiting for that day to happen. Oh my gosh, when that day comes, I can't wait to see the shit hit the wall. That's going to be hilarious. That's going to be funny as fuck, and I will be there to see it. Ask yourself why you are purchasing consoles. If you're going to get upset. Because to me, I got super happy about this. And it gave me a better reason to, you know, want to better my PC. Because I'm really excited to see how Horizon Zero Dawn not only looks like, but amazing games that you can create from it. By the way, Final Fantasy 13 looks incredible on PC. Good people. Incredible. Yo, fucking, I just found out there's Kingdom Hearts 2 randomizers. Randomizers! I might be streaming that shit, good people. Good gamers. Kingdom Hearts 2 randomizers? And you got fucking Epic putting the whole entire Kingdom Hearts series on that? Yo, modding can be... I'll wait 5 to 10 years and start playing that shit. I got time. I like this. Yes. Put them everywhere. Put games everywhere. Yo, Resistance on PC? Burn it with a fire. But it's on PS4, so we're good. Anyways, though, I'm pretty much done. Those are pretty much my two things. Hooray. You know, hooray for Rollback Netcode. Hopefully people can see that, you know what, if you are willing to support, if you're willing to boycott, if you're willing to say no on bullshit and use your platform and influence to let other people know, you can get things done. And I guarantee we're going to see it in KOF 15. And I want you to ask yourself, why do you buy the consoles you buy? Because if it ain't for the games, then you're crazy as hell. Because at this point, no one should be mad. Yeah, that's pretty much it. It's about that time of the show, I guess, where we have to say goodbye. So before we go, before we do, you already know what time it is. It's time for shameless plugging. Alrighty. Chronicles of Gamers. You can just Google me. I'm on YouTube. I'm on SoundCloud. I'm on Stitcher. I am on iTunes. And yeah. Just type us in Google if you want. We're also on Facebook. We're pretty much at the bottom if you're watching the video. For my audio people and my video people, you can also message us at the Chronicles of Gamers Podcast at gmail.com. Once again, you can message us at the Chronicles of Gamers Podcast at gmail.com. Also, you can also comment at the bottom if you're watching the video and let me know what you think. Shout out, support Rollback Netcode. Shout out boycotting, shout out sticking it to the man, and shout out going to where the games are. Power to the gamers. I'm stealing that because GameStop might disappear. It's mine. And you can't do shit to me, GameStop. Power to the gamers, motherfuckers. It's mine, and I'm keeping it. Anyways, thank y'all for tuning in. Thank y'all for watching. I'm out of here. And, of course, power to the gamers. My new catchphrase, fuckers. And I guess stay lit one last time.